Hello, I'm Dr. Robert Bastian. This is a video discussion about a chronic and sometimes severe coughing problem called sensory neuropathic cough, or SNC. This segment focuses on medications used for this condition. In case you didn't see earlier presentations about sensory neuropathic cough, first a review of what SNC is. It's an intractable neurological form of coughing based in a sensory disturbance of the throat, which patients may describe in various ways as a tickle, a dry sensation, pinprick, sandpaper, feeling of mucus dripping, and so forth. Those sensations precede just by an instant each coughing episode. The sensation is usually stereotyped, meaning it's fairly identical each time, or at least highly similar, and located most commonly here at the sternal notch, or at the level of the larynx, or higher, or sometimes the upper central chest. A person with SNC may have had their cough for months, years, or even several decades. A subset of persons with SNC may have periods of time relatively free of symptoms, but they often cough for several months after every upper respiratory infection, long past any active infection. Persons with mild SNC might cough a handful of times per day. By contrast, persons with severe SNC may endure literally hundreds of coughing spells each day. Now, that can include the nighttime with, of course, drastic disturbance of sleep. In many cases, attacks can be violent and protracted, lasting up to several minutes. Trigger events or actions that tend to sometimes seem to lead to the tickling and resultant cough include talking, singing, taking a deep breath, touching a spot on the neck, change of position such as bending over or lying down, swallowing, breathing cold air, and so forth. Some coughing attacks seem to happen spontaneously, of course. Well, what does a particularly bad episode of coughing look like to the observer? The individual may cough so hard that he or she turns red and the eyes and the nose start running. They may gag, retch, and even throw up. The person may lose urine involuntarily or worse. Some describe chest wall pain that results from the violent strain on the muscles between the ribs. We've even seen some cases with broken ribs or a burst blood vessel on the surface of the eye caused by the violence of the attack. Once in a while, they may experience laryngospasm when the vocal folds clamp together and block the airway briefly, causing a panicky feeling of suffocation with a loud breathing noise like Commonly, a person with SNC has been unable to find a clear diagnosis in spite of many doctor visits, tests, and treatment trials. Or he or she may have been given a firm diagnosis of one of what I call the usual suspects, that is allergy, asthma, and acid reflux, or COPD. But extensive treatments for those diagnoses have all failed to help. In summary, a very mild case of SNC may just be annoying. Moderate SNC begins to damage a person's sense of well-being and to interfere with work and social activities. Persons with severe SNC often say their lives are ruined. I've even had a few patients so severely affected that they have become depressed and even suicidal. You can imagine how someone in the very severe category might be unwilling to appear in public places because they might be humiliated by coughing so violent that they become the center of attention, not to mention wetting themselves, gagging, retching, throwing up, and so forth. Fortunately, an accurate diagnosis of SNC, either as a primary diagnosis or a diagnosis of exclusion, can open a brand new avenue of treatment through the use of a neuralgia medication. Now, neuralgia is pain resulting from nerve damage. SNC patients appear to have not typical pain from nerve damage, but instead a tickle, sandpaper feeling, pinprick, dripping mucus sensation, and so forth. The concept is that if neuralgia medicines calm down the pain of damaged nerve endings, then they may also calm down other sensations caused by damaged nerve endings. The catch is that there are several potential medications they don't all work the same for different persons, and so finding the best medication and dosing regimen can be a lot of work. Let me see now if I can help you become a full partner with your personal physician in the process of finding the best treatment for your SNC. Some background education about neuralgia medication, the general category of neuralgia medicine is in order first. Point one is, neuralgia medications were originally released to the market for another use, such as depression or seizures. If you don't know this, and you're given a neuralgia medicine for SNC, you might be confused to read a pharmacy printout about depression or seizures. As an analogy, just think about the insert included with aspirin that continues to speak of reducing fever and treating pain, even though a person might be taking it to thin the blood. A second point about these medications is that to achieve the same benefit, one person may need a tiny dose, another a medium dose, and a third person a high dose. That's why we start every person with SNC or laryngospasm at a low dose and then gradually increase until the desired benefit is achieved. After all, why use a high dose if a low dose works for you? Point three is that you must be persistent and motivated even if you are already exhausted with everything you've tried so far. Sometimes an initial medication tried for SNC does nothing, or it provides minimal benefit, or it has unacceptable side effects. If so, I would urge you not to give up, but to press on to the next medication trial, and if necessary, a third and fourth and so forth. A fourth point is that you will need to find a physician who can help you work your way to the optimal dose and timing of medication. So an office visit might need to be followed up with several messages back and forth between you and the office, because the number of those tweaks and changes of medication or dose or strategy is too great in some cases to permit face-to-face management of each of those adjustments. Point five is that while we always aim to find complete relief, we consider 85% reduction of symptoms or more really a good result. Now some, unfortunately, with our best try, only get 50% or even 30% reduction, and really unfortunately, about 1 in 20 persons we can't help, even after working our way through many medications. Well, with these 5 points of general introduction to the medications, let's talk first about some specific ones. One of the most used is called amitriptyline, and in persons over 65 years of age, we substitute the highly related medication, desipramine. We usually allow the patient to titrate him or herself from a tiny dose of 10 milligrams, and then if no response or partial response, move up to 2 pills or 20 milligrams, and then up to 3 pills or 30 milligrams and so forth, until either they achieve the benefit they need or they start to have some side effects that are beginning to bother them. We don't typically go above 80 to 100 milligrams with this medication. It seems appropriate to us that patients have the freedom to figure their exact dose out for themselves, of course, within the safe boundaries that we have taught them. If you get to 20 milligrams, for example, and coughing or laryngospasm is dramatically lessened to your satisfaction, you don't need to go any higher. If spasms were to start to occur again a few weeks later while you're still on 20 milligrams, you can go up to 30 and 40 and so forth. Well, if we get to 80 or 100 milligrams and there's no response, we move on to another medication and we begin the same process with it. If there is a good response but you have some breakthrough coughing late in the day, then we may add 10 or 20 milligrams of amitriptyline or desipramine at noon. Well, what about side effects? I mentioned the morning grogginess. Some also mention a dry mouth, or the occasional man with prostate trouble notes more difficulty urinating. A few have mentioned weight gain. Low doses seem fine for persons with high blood pressure, but blood pressure should be monitored if you're using the higher doses. Now, suppose a person tries amitriptyline or desipramine and it isn't working in one of the ways we've described. Well, we usually move next to gabapentin. Here, the strategy is a little different. We suggest 300 milligrams as a start at bedtime for 3 days. Then we do 300 milligrams at noon and bedtime for 3 days. Then we do 300 milligrams at breakfast, mid-afternoon with a snack, and bedtime for 3 days. And then finally we reach 300 milligrams at breakfast, lunch, dinner, and bedtime. Seems to be better with food. Now, some people take the dose in this same way, much higher, even to 600 milligrams or 900 milligrams, and I have one on 1200 milligrams 4 times a day. That's considered a huge dose. But we use the same strategy to get to those higher doses of increasing by just one capsule every 3 days. Very occasionally, a person may be highly sensitive to the side effects, and then we use the very same strategy, but we may start with 100 milligram capsules rather than 300 milligram capsules. Now, take special note that for this medication, both going up on the dose and going down, so increases and decreases, should be done gradually, as I said, usually changing by one pill every 3 days. Now, if amitriptyline and dazipramine and gabapentin are not right for you, then there is a list of other things we work our way through. Pregabalin, oxcarbazepine, citalopram, topiramate, capsaicin spray, and we continue trying all the others, and if we're having a struggle getting a result with the first one or two. Now let's summarize sensory neuropathic cough just in brief. It's neurological. The cough is typically associated with sensory experience of a tickle and or some sort of a sensation. The location is here or in the neck typically. Triggers means that you talk or you laugh loudly or you take that deep breath or you walk out in the winter and take the first lungful of cold air, and that triggers a spasm of coughing. There are a few to hundreds of episodes of cough per day. Some can be very violent. Treatment is via neuralgia medications, such as those I've just been talking about. We set up the dosage boundaries, and then you work within those boundaries and learn something about how you're responding, and then you report back to the physician via voicemail or email, and we usually use the percent reduction of cough as the main point of information that helps us decide what to do next. And we may go through many tweaks and adjustments before we find the best medication and dose. A great response is considered to be 85% reduction. Some can only achieve a little less reduction than that, however. And then we recommend that you don't quit until all ideas are exhausted, knowing that unfortunately maybe one of 20, we simply can't seem to find a solution. Thanks for listening to this presentation, and remember that it is offered not as medical advice to you, but to help you work more effectively with your personal physician. I hope it helps.